Charmaine, that was great. Thank you very much indeed. Really lays us up, sets us up for where we're going to go now. I mean, we're very used to SportAccord, indeed all sports conferences, talking about high performance, about achievement. Have I pressed a button? I might have hit a button there. Someone's hit a button. And this is all about high performance and achievement in the realm of health and physical well-being, not least for athletes, and that's where we're going to start. John Liljelund is with us. John is Secretary General of the International Floorball Federation, also a former international himself and an international coach, and is going to give us a snapshot of the way in which the Floorball Federation has embraced techniques and science, medical science, to enhance the status of athletes within the sport. John, thank you.
Well, I think the most important thing to start with is to say that the reason for this whole project we had with the injury prevention and the study made in correction to it was that at some point we started to see an advanced number of knee and ankle injuries occurring in floorball, which is a fast-paced game played on a synthetic or parquet floor indoors where you have some contact. The contact is actually not allowed, but you have some contact in respect shoulder to shoulder. But the interesting thing was that most of the injuries actually occurred when players didn't have enough neuromuscular power in their legs to make the turn. So, for example, going in this direction and seeing the ball going there, and then going there, and then either the ankle or the knee went. So this is the basis from where we start. So the idea was actually to look upon, in a sport where there is a lot of starts and stops, there are a lot of transition from one direction to the other, to see how we could, in principle, educate the coaches. Because most of the coaches in the sport, which is only about a little bit over 30 years old, actually have been players themselves. That was also the way I actually came in to become a coach. I started playing, then suddenly the women's team didn't have a coach, and there I was. So in the mid 2004, we started, and Ms. Kati Pasanen, who has been the driving motor behind, who is also now working at the Canadian, the University of Calgary, making injury prevention as a larger module, or also for basketball, I think ice hockey, and some other sports, we started discussing the issue and the possibilities of what we could do and how we can look upon it. And she then actually she studied women's floorball for a few years, and she looked upon what's there, how does it work, what happens. And then she started building a neuromuscular prevention program with activation before the practices, before the matches, and the results were really, really dramatic. We could see a quite decrease of injuries very quickly. And we started then, based on that, we started first then to it started, so first the women's leagues team started taking in the prevention program, then the men's league started taking in, then there was some coaches coming from other sports who started looking upon it, and then it started rolling out from there. And we took it into we run development seminars for coaches all around the world, about 42 so far, and we took it in 2008, 2009. We started using it and giving examples of how it can help in the prevention. So one of the ideas was, of course, then for us in then when looking on what is the real risk and what do you need to do, we then started also looking together with Ms. Pasanen, we started looking in at the injuries and defining what kind of injuries there are, not only from an epidemiological information, but also gaining direction for injury prevention and seeing where on the fields they happen. So we follow our three major events, the World Championships for men and women, the U19 World Championships, and the top club competition in the Champions Cup. We follow the players. We started in 2012, and we follow, so when every player is injured and away for more than one period, the team doctor has to report what the injury was like, what kind of injury it caused, and what then happened. And based on that, the study continues still, but the first article was published in the BMG Open Sport and Exercise Medicine Journal. in 2017. And it's quite interesting to see that even if you would think there was only about 21.2 injuries per 1,000 game hours on the top level. So the problem is actually not the top athletes. It's actually what was said before. It's the grassroots and the middle level athletes who maybe are not that fit, who then faces more problems. This form is a bit complicated, but it's in principle giving you a picture of like what data we are collecting. So it's pretty easy. Where did it happen? What happened? How did it happen? What was the physical part of the injury? What was the thing you were doing afterwards? And then based on that, we have been collecting this data now and putting it together. And working very closely with Ms. Pasanen, we then also then started looking for the four-step sequence of sports injury prevention research, which is the one Mehelen model, which was used in her PhD. And we think of trying to get to know what the typical injuries are, because it's much easier to go and say to a coach when you're trying to teach them, hey, look, these are the kind of things you need to be careful about. These are the things you need to avoid. And if you can't avoid them, especially one real, really big problem for our sport are slippery floors. If we play on older, let's say, in some parts of Europe, especially the eastern parts, there is a lot of old venues where we are playing, and there is a lot. The floor is quite slippery. So, for example, that then causes much more injuries as such when we play there than if we play on synthetic floor, which is clean. Other problem is that since there is not enough playing space for the sport, in a lot of countries we are playing in old warehouses where the club has built their own venue. So that means that they put some kind of subflooring, maybe not even that, and then a gear floor or Taraflex carpet on the floor. And when there is dust in the building and that goes down to the floor, that causes an enormous amount of slippery. And then when you try to stop and you don't stop, and then you first glide and then it comes the complete stop and then off you go. So the first step was in the study was to one season they followed up 374 players in the women's league. They looked upon how many injuries. That was 40.3 compared to the IFF study with only 20.2 per 1,000 game hours. And 77% of the injuries were lower extremity injuries. So this was quite clear that the overall interest here is to look upon the legs and where we have most, because there are not that much physical contact to the upper body. Though the goalkeepers, which I happen to represent and still am representing, is of course the fact that we don't have shoulder and elbow and wrist problems. So then in the prevention study going forward, the typical non-contact injury situations is quick direction change, sudden stopping or cutting, and usually without any physical contact from the opponent or your own player, but that should be a little bit more less normal. So what then actually was done was to build a neuromuscular prevention measures, which started up with the fact that you start from the toes and you build it up all the way up to the neck, in principle, to warm all the small neuromuscular muscles in the whole body. I'm not a doctor, so if I say any kind of term is wrong, I mean, my medical school career was quite short. So the idea is that when you do this and you teach the players to do this every time, in every practice, regardless if you are on the court or you're doing something else before the court, so it's a warm-up process. You actually are warm and the player is much more ready to go into the court when the real play or the real practice with the ball starts. And this is something, it says here 20 to 30 minutes. In principle, it has now been put to about 15 minutes. And when we start with kids that are about 8 years of age, in a few weeks they know it. And it's something which happens automatically. And you can see before the game, in for example, junior series, you can tell when you look at the warm-up, they are doing something, everybody, the same thing together, and they are standing and shooting. You know from the start which team will win. Because the fact is that in the first period, the team who did the injury prevention warm-up, they will be ready. They will be physically ready also. So it's not only a question about injury prevention, it's also a question about making yourself ready to do the stuff. I had a video, but it was so big, so I couldn't do it. But the main idea here is then you go through different things. You go through ankles, you go through knees, you go through hips. You do static movements and try to bring the whole body around to look upon it, to be ready to go in. I hope you will have the presentation so you can see what what it was, and I can actually later, but that there wasn't enough bandwidth in the hotel to download the video to send it further. But I think the most important thing is that we do this, and which I would say is the recommendation, we do this all year around. It's not only a thing you do when you practice the sport as such, but it's also for every practice we do. And it's something which is non-negotiable, it becomes. And when we have introduced this to in the development seminars to new countries and new coaches, it's like you can see the light going up and going on, oh, that we haven't thought about. So, just a short example, the components, there are certain sport-specific running drills, there are some balance exercises, there are some lower limb pliometrics and agility things, and some strengthening exercises, which are all done at the same time. And then we build different programs in different cases for different teams. But what I would say is the most important thing, and also is that the fact we came up with was that the lower limb injury risk was reduced with 66% based on the introduction of the injury prevention. And we then also then had the possibility to run this in a control group run by Ms. Pasanen. And now actually this experience is used in Calgary, University of Calgary, of building this. I think they're working with basketball at the moment of building a similar kind of setup based on this study. So the message, a neuromuscular warm-up program, it was really effective in preventing acute non-contact leg injuries. The contact ones are of course different. The neuromuscular warm-up training should be included in all the weekly training of all floorball players, which has been done, and we have actually then integrated it into the development seminars as a recommendation when we go out and speak to the new coaches. So I think that's all for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. Very clear example. The proof's in the pudding, isn't it? The statistics, well, they do lie sometimes, but I think on this occasion it's quite clear they make a difference. I mean, that's about short, sharp, twist, turn sort of sport. I don't like it when you go, but we get the clear impression as to what can happen. We're now going to go to the other extreme in a way, because I want to ask Tegla to come and join me. Tegla Loroupe, who you will know very well, a great marathon runner, New York Marathon winner twice, holding the world record time for the New York Marathon as well, world half marathon winner. And then we're talking to a certain extent about post-career life. Tegla is a UN ambassador, a peace and sport ambassador, and of course, famously, the chef de mission for the Olympic refugee team. So, Tegla, thanks very much for joining us, and we're very keen to hear what you have to say. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I feel more nervous. This is not marathon. This is about Tegla. Well, I'm really happy to be here. I just want to thank all my friends who invited me to be in this place. My first time in the SportAccord, but I see the faces of friends and sports people. Of course, we have doctors. Thank you, Professor Yannis, my friend here. This is all about Tegla Loroupe. I started running. I just want to tell you a little bit about myself.
Tegla literally burst onto the international scene with a startling win in the 1994 New York City Marathon. This was the first major victory by an African woman. After her victory in the 1994 New York City Marathon, Tegla was a marked woman, but it mattered not. By the 24-mile mark, Tegla Loroupe was alone, dominating the competition, much to the delight of the Central Park crowd. During the course of her career, Tegla had won New York City twice, London, Berlin, and Rotterdam three times. With a world record,
Tegla is on world record pace, a record set in London in 1984 by Ingrid Christensen of Norway.
Loroupe is clearly paced by two Tegla men, which is not illegal in mixed gender races.
But
Tegla Loroupe at 1998 Rotterdam, a world record, 2 hours, 20 minutes, and 47 seconds.
Thank you. Nice is that the sports bring people together, and also for health. Sports people are always healthy, and it takes people from one continent to another. For example, myself, if it was not because of sports, I would be in Africa. I would not be in this part of the world. So I can say sports is something, it's a drive or it's a pilot to many lives. My message for peace is for everybody to love and support also, and also to discourage those who are doing wrong things. Because if we don't discourage others with a good faith, we will not have peace in the world. And let us not get tired preaching about peace. And when we talk about peace, there are so many problems, and we have to understand what causes the conflict. So we have to address the problems so that we can have peace.
After my career, I decided to go and do something in our region, and because I came from a conflict area, and through sports, I was able to have a name. And here you can see the refugees athlete. I worked with the refugees athlete. Why? Because these people, I realized that they need our help. And I got all their names, Tegla working with criminals people. But for me, I understand they were not criminal people. Anybody can be a refugee. But thanks to the support of IOC and many other people, IWF, and also my country for supporting these people. When we came to Rio, it opened doors for many, many people. It was something special. It was emotion. And for me, I forgot that I was dealing with the criminal, as the people talked about, but I was dealing with the people that needed my help. And it gave us sanity. Now, from refugee to what happened in our continent and the progression of marathon for men in Africa, nobody talk about women, but we talk about men. So you see why it came down. This is when Africa or East Africa came into the world of sports.
The Kenyan drive for athletic success began at the same Mexico Olympics where Mamo Walde had won the marathon for Ethiopia. But in the 10,000 meters, he came up against a Kenyan named Temu.
80 yards and it's Temu attacking. Temu of Kenya against World Ethiopia. And Temu is going to take the gold medal. Kenya's going to get it. And World is beaten. Temu wins.
The great rivalry was born.
Today, why people or there is what we call Africa dominating? The first point is for me, I can say it's out. You can read the rest. It's all about hard working. It's all about educating our people. It's all about, well, we are advantage of training high altitude. But for me, as an athlete, it's all about hard work. And listen to the people who talk to you. You can see the picture here. We did not have all, if I had this, let's say scientific, whatever, but it's through listening to the coaches, through listening to yourself and eat well. Sorry. In one of the blue T-shirt athletes, he was wearing blood and sweat. Blood and sweat is all about struggle. It's not only about Africa. It's for any individual that works hard instead of using drugs. Well, we did very well in Rio. But we came second. But there is a question whereby many... Let us not cheat ourselves. I feel sad because after Rio, some of our athletes were caught in drugs. And that is not a fair game. The whole world is looking at us. Why? Because we are using some use drugs. And clean athletes, nobody is protecting them. Today, we can talk about how are we going to work together. We have to have this holistic approach. When you have two legs, and when one leg is broken, you cannot stand. But we need what to call education. We need protection. We need other things that makes us together to stand for our sports today and for our people today. I can say it, the world of today, we are happy to have people like Professor Ayones, Sub 20 project. He cannot work alone. When we have people like Haile Gebrselassie, who launched this project, he was a clean athlete. And together, we can use such a people. Our athletes today, they are lucky because they have all these things. If I had all the support, I think maybe I could be running maybe 2 or 5 like men. But our athletes today, they are lucky. But don't forget that we have also what we call cartels, that they are using drugs to cut shortcuts. How are we going to deal with these people? It's all up to us. Thanks to the organization led by Professor Ayanes. You can see, I don't want to explain, but our sports today, we fight doping. We will stand a good chance. We have athletes like Bekele, who was out of the competition. But through the scientific support, natural way, he came back and ran very well. We have our athlete, former world record. He was supported in a natural way, and today he's having a very good time. Well, these are our partners, and they cannot do alone. We need each other. We need to support these people so that we can make a better world for our sports today. Thank you very much.